Thanks for coming. This is a wonderful turnout. I appreciate y'all coming. This presentation is not about the best of Rudy. It is about the best of Ruby and how that relates to the SketchUp program. You are here. This is the first session. And I suspect you guys are here because the other rooms were full. All right. So I appreciate you coming. Visualize the end of the day. All right. We're going to have a lot of fun in here. I want this to be interactive. When Jonathan Dormady asked me to present 3D Basecamp 2008, I was honored. And I presented it 2005, which means they asked me back. And I said, well, what do you want me to talk about? He says, well, how about the best of Ruby? And I said, well, what does the best of Ruby mean? Does that mean you want me to talk about all the Ruby scripts that I've written? And I even asked Google, I said, you know, define the best of, and I didn't get a response. And so I kind of put it out to some of the community forums, and I got a lot of feedback pretty quick. And so I've tried to touch on all those scripts that the SketchUp user community feels make them the most productive. Part of what we're going to get today is not just talk about the scripts. I'm going to talk about the people behind the scripts. You know, most of us know them by their screen names or see their avatars or whatever. So I'm going to talk a little bit about them, give you short bios, who they are. You're going to meet a couple today as well, which is kind of neat. I'm going to talk about how Ruby scripts have evolved since 2004. In 2004, we'll look at some of the scripts that were out then, and we'll compare those towards the end of the presentation with some of the most current scripts, and you'll see the big difference. So Ruby is kind of exponentially going up as far as usability and function and user interface. So what's happening right now is really nice. I am going to get into some script demos, and so I'll kick off SketchUp and run some of these scripts so you can see how they work. Now, we only have like an hour and 15 minutes or so, and I have a bunch of scripts to talk about, so I'm not going to get deep on any of them. We have the labs available, so if you want some lab time with me or any of these other scripters, just grab me and we'll go to the lab and we'll get as deep as you want to get. We're not talking about programming today. We tried that in 2005, and we had a lot of glossy eyes in the presentation. So, and plus, it was right after lunch, so no programming. When we're getting programming, we'll talk about it in the lab. So this is from a user perspective. You know, how do you use these Ruby scripts? What do they do? What can they do for you? And then let's have fun. If you have a question as we're going, raise your hand. If I'm not paying attention, some of the Google people here will help me. I can either repeat your question, or if you want to queue up at the microphone, we can do that as well. So I want this to be fun. I'm going to have fun. Okay, a little bit about me. I leave a lot of things, okay? So I'm 45 years old. In 2002, I was a programmer, and I got laid off, and I couldn't find a job. So I went into woodworking, one of my passions. And so I did that professionally, and I was using a bunch of software that didn't work very good, and I found SketchUp in 2003, so I got version 3, 3.1 came out right after that, and it was wonderful. And in 2004, I left woodworking to go back into IT, and I've been in IT ever since. Okay, so now I got some questions. How many people in here have never used a Ruby script? Okay, so we got a third of the people at least that haven't used a Ruby script. All right, how many people have downloaded a Ruby script, tried to download it, tried to install it, and maybe used one or two? Okay, so that's about the same percentage, I guess. And then how many people here depend on Ruby scripts in their use of SketchUp? Okay, so we got maybe a quarter of the people here. All right, and how many people in here have written a Ruby script? Wow, this is great. I want to meet you guys. Okay, now a little bit of the history. In SketchUp version 3, there wasn't a Ruby API. SketchUp version 3 had a debug menu that if you did the right keystrokes, you could pull it up, and there was this thing there for macros. So it's like, you know, version 3 macros, hey, this could be a good thing, but it really didn't do anything, and I think it was even set up for Visual Basic. So whoever the genius was that picked Ruby as the language, do we know who that was? Was it Tyler? Joe? Of course, the genius. And thank you. It's a great language. I didn't know a thing about it in 2004, but I learned quickly. All right, so Ruby came out in June of 2004. Remember, I'm woodworking. It's June 2004. I put down the woodworking tools, and I'm sitting at the computer every day not making a dime. I caught into it. I loved it. It was great. All right, version 5, the Scrambler came out. We can now encrypt Ruby scripts, and the Sandbox tools came out, courtesy of Tyler Miller. Tyler will be up here a little bit later to give you a quick demo of those. And then version 6, this is huge. All right, and this is just kind of in its infancy as far as the use of this. And this is where the user interface for SketchUp, for Ruby scripts has just, I mean, it's just broken all boundaries. We can do pretty much anything we want with web dialogs and observers. If you've ever gone into SketchUp 6 and you've seen the units dialog to pick your units or the learning center, those are Ruby scripts with the web dialogs. All right, so it looks just like a real part of the program, so Ruby scripts can do the same thing. Okay, in the beginning, some of the first Ruby scripts, the first one that was written by non-Google Atlas person was num. All right, we're going to see a demo of that. It's really cool. And then drop, and TBD, he's not here, but he's here in spirit. I came out with make faces. How many in here have ran make faces? Okay, quite a bit. And then repair broken lines. So again, simple interface, initial of the Ruby scripts. Okay, so as time went on with Ruby scripting, they got a little bit more advanced. Rick Wilson, who's right here, he's going to talk about Windowizer shortly. That's an awesome script. And then House Builder. This is the first script that blew me away. I mean, Rick, yours was cool, but House Builder blew me away. All right, it's like, wow. And then the 3D text tool came out, and that was pretty cool. And version 6 has that in it now. Now, today, we have things like Sketchy Physics by Chris Phillips, Freeform Deformation, Subdivide and Smooth. Has anybody seen Subdivide and Smooth? Good. Not very many people have. And then Tools on Surface. This is brand new, Tools on Surface. Anybody seen this? Okay. All right, you guys. How many brand new SketchUp users in here? Okay, just a couple. So most people have been using, say, maybe a year or two. People are shaking their heads, yes. Okay, this is good. So Tools on Surface is really nice. All right, there's several places to get. I'm guessing this presentation will be loaded up later. I don't know if it'll just be videoed, but I'll make it available to Google to post. But hyperlinks for all the different places to get scripts. Okay, so the first script that I used to learn how to do Ruby stuff, and it's still distributed with SketchUp today, was called box.rb. And it had a nice dialogue, and this was, other than having drop downs, this was about the most sophisticated you could get with the user interface. You could have text boxes or drop downs, okay, cancel type things. And so you put the dimensions in and it drew a box. You know, I took this, extended it for the very first cabinet script I wrote for woodworking. And so what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start getting into some of the early scripts and the profiles of the different authors that are out there. Tavi, he goes by Tavi Octavian or TBD on the forums. He's a SketchUp programmer. He's a consultant. He lives in Romania. He tried to come to 2005 and 2008, but visas weren't working for him. So the very first script that he did was num. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to run num for you. And I'm kind of cramped on space over here, so bear with me, please. Plus, I'm left-handed. Okay, there's a good-looking web dialogue. All right, I got all my cheat sheets here. Num. Okay, now remember, this is the first Ruby script that ever came out. Okay, y'all catching that? Now, I just want you to know that I've allocated about 6 minutes per script. Okay, but it has a real cool feature, too. I can type in 200. Ooh. Okay, so that was it. But that was big, right? Because nobody had written one yet. And so we're all inspiring each other as we're doing this. All right, and so after NUM, he came out with DROP. All right, and so DROP was really cool. And a lot of people are still using DROP today. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to generate some random boxes here. All right, and I'm going to close this. And I'm going to scroll out. And so we just have a whole bunch of random boxes here. And I'm going to select them. And I'm going to right click. And I'm going to say drop. And the Z level is 0. Okay, and so now we have dropped everything on the XY plane. All right, so that's kind of cool. I mean, or you could do a drop at intersection. So if you're landing trees on your topo, then you know this is a pretty cool script. Okay, and then TBD has done several research projects. One of the latest ones that he's done was to take materials in SketchUp and replace those, kind of hook into OpenGL and replace that with a video texture. And so you can really have videos inside your SketchUp model. I don't have a demo with that, it runs on Windows, but it's pretty cool. Now, if any of you guys want to pick up that project from him, he'd be happy to let you pick it up and keep going with it. You know, another thing is this is an advanced session I just read this morning, and so I'm taking the liberty to use any term that I want when I'm talking to you. And so if I say a term that you guys don't know what it is, feel free to ask and interrupt me. Right now, Tavi's working on a rendering program called Podium, and Podium's pretty cool. Podium is a way to render while you're inside SketchUp. And there's a lot of work going on with the rendering engines and exporters today, and he's doing that as well. Okay, I'm not French, and so this guy for the last several years has been Didier. I sent him an email the other day. I said, how do I pronounce your name? And it's Didier. He's French, so super nice guy. Now, I need help real quick from Johnny. You're on. Yeah, right here.
Okay. 1, 2. So the guy's an architect, as you can see, and he's working, in fact, at École Nationale Supérieure d'Architecture de Nancy.
All right. I know a lot of languages, but they're like C++ and Ruby, not French. Okay. Didier is Mr. Library Depot. All right, who here has downloaded a script from the Ruby Library Depot? If you haven't, you need to. He takes every one of the scripts that are out there and he puts them on his website and he indexes them, and it's awesome. And it's a lot of work to do that, I know. Now, he's come out not too long ago with a tool called the Component Spray Tool. And the Component Spray Tool, we're going to dump back into SketchUp. And we're going to see the component spray tool. And I'm not going to go through all the options, and there's a lot of options. There's like a 14-page PDF that he's written that is excellent for how to use this tool. And the theory here is if any of you guys have ever shot an aerosol can, you know, like bug spray at a cockroach or something, you know, it comes out from one point and goes out. And so the component spray tool is the kind of thing. You push a button, and you spray components into your model. All right, and so if you want to put pebbles on a beach or put cactus in your desert or, you know, snowflakes on your house, this is the kind of script that you will want to use. All right, and the only thing I have to do is remember where all these tools are. Okay, so the component spray tool, here's what we're going to do. We're going to create, still in NUM, it won't go away. Okay, so we're just going to create a surface here, and we don't need to. But No, we're going to create a component. Nothing like live. Okay, so we'll create a bunch of disk. Make a component. Nope. All right, looks good to me. Okay, now we're going to delete it. And now we're going to run the component spray tool. Okay, so it'll automatically figure out that you have components, and it'll give you a list of 6 different components to spray at once, and then in each drop down you can pick either the same one or everything else. And so we're going to just have this one component. We're going to have, we can pick our pattern, or spray pattern, if you will. Default's a circle. We'll stay with a circle. That's fine. Spray pressure, this is density. You know, how dense do you want these things to come out? We're not going to scale it. We're going to keep things vertical. And we're just going to say OK. And so we're going to kind of move out a little bit. And we're going to draw our circle for the spray pattern. And then we have our component sprays. And these are overlapping. They're kind of fat. So let's just make a bigger circle. OK. This is a very nice script. All right, and so maybe I didn't want to create 700. Yeah, we don't want to do this. OK. Anyway, you get the picture. All right, so that's a component spray tool. Oh, it did create them. This is good. All right, and you can have options for overlapping. I mean, this is kind of an ugly example, but if you were doing trees on a topo, you can do them in a line. You can do them in different shapes. You can have, does everybody know what the word face normal means? This is an advanced session. Anybody doesn't, that's okay. Face normal. Okay, face normal. If a face in SketchUp, all right, you know what a face is in SketchUp. A face can be pointing several different ways, all right? Face normal means if a component was added to it and it was face normal, the component would be perpendicular with the face, all right? And then keep vertical means if you put a tree on a hillside, face normal would be sticking out the side of the mountain. Face keep vertical, it would stay straight up. Okay. Okay, now Didier has done other scripts. He's got a nice layer manager. He's got an exporter to SU2POV. He's got Project Pack, ADO, Active Drawing Objects. There's a lot of different functionality in Active Drawing Objects. And then he's got Cloud, which is a really nice script. Okay, TIG, he's... I don't call him a new scripter because I don't want to take anything away from TIG. He's a great scripter, but he's fairly new on the scene compared to some of the people, but not as new as some of the others. He has he's a senior architect in the UK. He's really active on the forums. His personal favorite of all the scripts that he's written is Roof, and he's an architect, and so it's a pretty sophisticated script for drawing roofs. So if you're an architect, that's really good. He's got one section face cut, which when you do a section cut in SketchUp, and you like pull a wall, you see a hollow wall, and so this will put a face on that wall. So if you wanted to export an image with a section face cut with the face on it, then that's a script that you want. Slicer is really nice. I don't have the math skills personally to do something like Slicer and Volume Calculator, but he's got the calculus background. He's written these scripts, are available, and so you can pretty much take any shape you want. There's another calculator out there, but it only works on basically an object's bounding box. So if you're taking the volume of a cube, it's perfect. If you're doing a pyramid or a cone, it doesn't work. Use Volume Calculator. Pipe Along Path, we're going to demo real quick. And Pipe Along Path, we're going to just create a random path. All right, and then we're going to select it. And we're going to remember where it is, pipe along path. All right, and so now we have options for, you know, the outside diameter, how what the wall thickness is of this pipe is going to be. And we say OK, and we can go back over here and look at the end of this pipe, and we can see that we have a nice pipe. So pipe along path is really nice. It's, you know, it's a little bit faster than follow me. Plus, it has the flexibility where you don't have to really draw your donut section or your cross section of your pipe. You can just specify that. So if you're into chemical plants or something like that, you can do it in wireframe and let it go. Kind of a neat thing with pipe along path, you could select, for instance, a circle and do pipe along path, and you get a torus. This is not a very good one because it's kind of big, but that's a nice quick way to do a torus. Okay, now I don't use AutoCAD, but he's got this set of XRef tools. Anybody in here using XRef tools? Yeah, I see a lot of hands. This is a good set of scripts, right? People that are shaking their head, yes. All right, so that's a great one. And then Mirror. You know, SketchUp, you can do mirroring in SketchUp with a right-click context menu, flip along red, green, or blue axis. But this is a little bit simpler approach. It's kind of not so hidden for a lot of people. A lot of people want to know how to do mirror, and it's, you know, maybe a trial and error kind of thing. Mirror's nice. You can pick the axis, and it'll flip everything over for you. And it works most of the time. Okay, Steve Hurlbut, I tried to get a hold of Steve. Yes, sir. Yeah, I don't know. Okay. The question was, how do...
It works just like an AutoCAD.
Okay, could you come over here real quick?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. What's your name?
Dave.
All right, thank you, Dave. He's going to repeat the question and answer it. This is great.
He asked how the XRef manager works.
And if you use AutoCAD a lot, it works just like AutoCAD, where you could have multiple SketchUp files and XRef them all together into one SketchUp file. And so you can then go back and edit your original file and then update the X reference into your base file. So for instance, if you have a site plan, you've got 30 buildings, and you got 30 people in your office each working on a building, they can all be working on their buildings individually. You can X reference them into the site plan. And then when someone changes their building, just update that X reference and the building updates automatically. it's on the forums. You can get it on the forums and at Ruby Depot.
Yeah, you can go to the Ruby Depot. It's a free download.
It's really powerful. Sometimes you have to be careful about going back the other way. So if you're in your base file and you've X-referenced a building in and then you modify it in the base file and someone else is modifying it out there with the original, sometimes you have to be careful of that. But it works just like an AutoCAD. It's really powerful.
Does it announce when something's changed?
I don't remember if it announces, but if you go update X-reference, it'll tell you which ones need to be updated. Yeah.
Okay, so if you're working CAD and SketchUp together, it sounds like it'd be a really nice tool, and I just don't do CAD. Okay. Okay, Steve Hurlbut, this guy shows up out of nowhere. I think he's maybe up in Minnesota or something. I don't know where he is. I couldn't get a hold of him. Tried to, but he wrote, it's like Norman Greenbaum, Spirit in the Sky, right? One-hit wonder. All right, that's what this is. He came and gave us a script and was gone. But... it's awesome. All right, this is one of the scripts that just blew me away. We're going to go into SketchUp now, and we're going to run House Builder. And we're going to start off with a foundation. All right, we just did that. We could have used his tool to do it. But we're going to go into House Builder. We're going to draw. All right, and we're going to start with the wall tool. And, you know, you pick some options. And this is all old interface stuff, but it works great. You know, pick your justification, your size of your lumber, height of your plate. And so there's all kinds of different options for that. We're just going to take the default. And so we're going to pick, that's the start of the wall. That's the end of the wall. We have a wall. Okay? We're going to start here, we're going to go over here, and we have a wall. All right, and people are shaking their heads in amazement, and I still do every time I see it. It's got a roof associated with it, but one of the things that really blew me away was his right-click context menu. Okay, so you select something, you right-click, and you say edit wall. Okay, and so we can change wall properties, windows, doors. All right, so we're gonna just add a door, and we're gonna pick, you know, the shape and the size of the door. I'm just taking the defaults, and so now it's ready to listen. Now you see that green inference line? All right, we're picking the middle of the door anywhere along this wall, and so we're gonna get kind of tricky with it and have it screw up some studs. And he reframes the wall, puts the header in, does the jack studs. I mean, is this good, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, this is good? Yes, sir, question. This is free. Ruby Depot. Yes, sir. Can I put the sheetrock? No, I don't think it does sheetrock. I don't think it does sheetrock. It doesn't do sheetrock, no. Oh, it does? It does sheetrock. Yes, you can put sheetrock on it. Okay. All right. He was telling me how to do it. That's wonderful. Question back here. Yes, sir.
Can you go to the intersection of the walls at the corner?
Yes. You want to see that? Now, I'm not sure exactly about how I picked the corner to see how it reframed the corner, but looks like a valid corner to me. I could use another style. I think, here, let's do this. Let's go over to the other corner. And let's make sure we're going to add a wall. And we're not even going to go all the way across this time. All right. Yeah, that's good enough for Texas building code. So, yeah, I mean, I've seen it frame the corner different. You can set the justification on the wall, so I would encourage you to experiment with that. We had a question in the way back. I can't hear you. I can't hear
you.
Will it do a block wall? I don't know what a block wall is. I'm not an architect.
Concrete block.
I think this just does, let's look. I don't use these things. I just program them. Okay. Oh, we can spray blocks. This is good. I told you we were going to have fun today. Okay, so it's got a gable tool, a roof tool, a floor tool, and then some global parameters. So wall tool, and then we can have... Yeah, I think it's just lumber. I could change it to do concrete blocks. Yeah, question right here.
Yeah, before you go much farther, would you take us through like how to actually download the script and plug it in?
I'll tell you what, I'll do that at the end.
Okay, good.
I'll go through the process of, I'll go to Ruby, I'll go to Smuster, then I'll buy a $20 script so you guys know how to do that. No, I'll go to the Ruby library detail and we'll do that. Okay, and there's another question right here. Yes.
So after making these walls and framing, are they grouped? Are they components like these?
They're, I believe they're components. Let's check. Thank you. All right, so to find out what something is, you right-click and say Entity Info, and it says this is a group on layer one. All right, so these are just groups. They're not components. And I would imagine that grouping is probably the good way to go because you're not going to have two walls that are the same. Now, I believe the actual 2x4.
Yeah, that's what I call.
Okay.
That's a group.
That's a group. That should be a component.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. Good question.
All right, guys. Modify
that. Yeah. Any other questions? I saw another hand. We're okay? All right. So... You know, I don't have time to go through the roof tool and the gable tool and everything else. They work. I mean, this is a fantastic script. I mean, for visualization, for throwing up a house real quick, adding windows. I mean, awesome. I don't know any product you can do that in, and you know, like 10 minutes, and you can do a two-story house with staircases. I mean, it's there's a lot of. I'm sorry, question? This doesn't have any BIM or BOM type export as far as quantities, but again, from a Ruby standpoint, that is very doable. I've done some custom BIM scripts, so it's just a matter of looping through the model and doing counts and links and surface areas and yeah, all that. It's absolutely, you can do BIM stuff with this. Yes?
How have you downloaded this script, right?
Yes. It depends on
the.
Yeah, the question is, if he downloaded this script, can he change it? Every script author has his own rules for what you can and can't do. Like, you know, the contact information for Steve is not in the script. I couldn't get a hold of him. I don't know. It's pretty much in the public domain. I think it's warranted. Is this, you know, no guarantees that this will work kind of a thing. But I don't know if it's copyright Steve or not. You know, some scripts have full end-user license agreements where you want to talk to them. They can get them customized, give you permission, whatever. So every script is pretty much different. Yes, question?
I think there's a guy in France
that's changed to metric who can give you a bit of information. Well, this is Didier, who runs the script library, has converted House Builder to metric. So if you want metric studs, you can have metric studs. So like I say, it's a lot of work the Didier is doing for the Ruby community for this. Yes, question? Yeah, you want to see a window? All right. All right, so we're going to right-click this. We're going to edit the wall. We're going to add a window. I'm going to take all the defaults, and I'm going to click, and we got a window. So it looks like it picked right the center of the window as far as, I mean, the header and the height and everything else was in the dialogue. So, I mean, it's awesome. It's awesome. I can't tell you how many sheds I've made with this and never built. Yeah, question.
Once you pop that window in, can you move the window?
Yes, I know you can. Well, I know you can. I'm not going to go there. I don't think I'm going to have enough time to go through it all, but there's editing. The editing is amazing. Right-click, edit window, and yes, it's awesome. Yeah, you can edit. Okay, so, I mean, I could use House Builder all day. It's great. Okay, so, Steve. Okay, Rick Wilson. Rick's going to come up, and he's going to talk about Windowizer. So, 2-3 minutes. Do the best you can.
I'm Rick Wilson. My vocation is architecture. My hobbies are Ruby and music. And so, a lot of the ideas I get for Ruby scripts come from just working and using it in architecture. That's where Windowizer came from. I found myself doing a lot of curtain walls, storefront windows, that kind of thing, and decided I need to do something about this. It's hard to draw these things by hand all the time. So what I ended up with was Windowizer. What I've done is drawn a box that would be representative of a building. This would be representative of one of the walls. What I've done is drawn a rectangle where I want the window to be. That's where I want it to go. Right click, come down to Windowizer, and Windowize. Then the dialog asks for the different settings. How many rows do I want? That's how many horizontal sections. How many columns do I want? Parameters for frame width and height, mullion width, mullion height. How far do I want the frame to be pushed back into the wall is the frame inset. Then how far behind the face of the frame do I want the glass to be? That's the glass inset. And then frame and glass colors. So let's do something with 2 rows and 4 columns. And we have that. Oh, thank you. Oh, that's right. It's okay.
Can you edit when it's done?
Sure.
The question is, can you edit when it's done? And the answer is yes.
Yes. I'll do another one. One of the little-known features about Windowizer is that you can use proportional spacing on the rows and the columns, so they don't have to be all the same relative to each other. So let's say you were working on a storefront that was 7 foot high, and you needed a 2 foot window at the bottom, 2 foot height at the bottom, and then 5 foot high at the top. So you could do 2, 5. And let's say we want to change, we still want four columns, but we don't want them the same width. So we could go 2, 3, 3, 2. Leave the rest of those the same. There. Then there was a question about editing the window. Windowizer, edit window. And you can change a window to the current settings. So if I had a window that had different parameters, I could change them to the settings I just plugged in. That's already what it is. So no, we don't want to use the current settings. We want to do something else. We decided architecturally that that needed to be a 5 and that needed to be a 5. And so we hit OK and it changes the proportional spacing. So,
is this
component right now? No, it is just straight geometry right now. It's just, you can select on any of the faces. Yes.
Yes. The question was, can you create a component from that window? And the answer is yes.
Yeah. Oops. So, different keyboard shortcuts. Okay. I'm sorry? It does not do that yet. I'm working on version 4, which should take care of a lot of things. One of the limitations, unfortunately,
hold on. The question was, will it double cut a wall?
So if you have it.
Not yet.
Yeah. If you have a wall thickness, the thing you can do right now is copy the original rectangle face to the other wall face and then run Windowizer with opposite parameters on each side. Or you can group it and do a negative scaling factor on it to get it to the other side. So,
question.
Okay, the question is, can you select a polygon? No, it's set up to select the face, and then it uses the edges that bound the face to derive all the geometry for it. Good question. Smuster.com.
Yeah, the question is, where can you download it? Smuster.com. It's a free script.
Free script.
Question in the back.
I'm sorry? You can. It's
the question is, can you put a door in your window?
I'm really bad about repeating the questions here.
Oh, a storefront with a door.
Okay. Yep. Okay.
Just go with a yes or no on that one. And
okay.
Going.
Yeah.
Okay.
You can. It takes a little bit of work. You have to push-pull the frame down and then use Windowizer to create a door, and I can do that for you, too. But
okay.
We don't have time.
Yeah. What's the next question back here?
Okay, first question was, can you use non-rectangular faces? Yes and no. It won't do the mullions with a non-rectangular face, or if you have a rectangle that has one of the faces broken into, or one of the edges broken into two parts. That's something I'm working on for version 4 also. And then the second question, I just lost it. Oh, okay. Yeah, you can.
And repeat the question.
The question was, can you use a negative extrusion, I think, is to pop something out. So the answer to that would be yes. And the reason you might want to do that would be like ceiling tile. So it's sideways, but it's right in front of me. So that's what we're going to do.
Okay, we don't have time.
Okay.
Okay, was there another question? Yes, sir.
You said before that it has only one face and you have to work this wall to make the entire face. If you have a wall, let's say 1 foot deep, can you punch a hole in the wall and then put the Windowizer on the external surface or internal surface of that wall, and it's going to be from the inside?
Yes, the question was, could you punch the hole in the wall yourself and then use Windowizer on a drawn face? The answer would be yes, you could do that.
So it's going to be the internal face
too. You would have to do both faces separately. When I wrote it, I was doing 3D exteriors.
Okay.
strictly exteriors, and so I wasn't worried about interior faces. And that's the. You can how do you combine them together? You can manually group them, select both sides of the window, and then make a group or a component out of those.
But then you have two glasses.
Right.
Okay.
We need to move on. So catch me at a lab or between sessions, and I'll be happy to explain more.
Okay. Wow. Okay, and he's also working on Image Profile, which is a script that will take a transparent ping and programmatically turn that into a SketchUp thing, all right? It'll read the pixels in the image, and it'll make components. It'll make a component. Yes, sir, question.
What's that called?
Image Profile. Image Profiler?
Profile.
Profile. Image Profile. Smustered. Okay, all right. This guy is Tyler Miller, okay? Tyler Miller is going to come up, or not, okay? And he's going to demonstrate the sandbox tools. Now, the sandbox tools came out with version 5. They're not new, but they're very powerful. And so Tyler is going to demo the set of scripts that he wrote. He didn't really want to do it, but I told him he could have a piece of beef jerky if he did it.
I should say, can you guys hear me? A word about how these APIs kind of come out. You would think the main desire here is for us to provide the ability to create a bunch of new tools for SketchUp. And the reality is it comes about because we're kind of lazy as developers. And we get overwhelmed with all these requests. And we think, how can we sucker other people into doing this for us? I assume Joe will back me up on that motivation there. It comes about, that way, and we're constantly just amazed with what folks like Todd and Rick and everybody else does with the API and the quality of the tools that come out of it. So we couldn't be more pleased. So the sandbox tools represent an utter failure for us to sucker somebody else into doing tools for landscape architecture market. So I had to do them. So let's get a new file in here. So we're in plan view here, and I'll eliminate the broken toolbar. Sandbox tools on, Todd? Or do we need to?
Talk to Dusty.
Sandbox tools are, not system preferences, SketchUp preferences. Are actually an extension to SketchUp, which you need to flip on. Oops. There we go. So now we have an extra set of tools in here. And one of the things that we kept getting a request for was people were getting contour maps. From CAD, from the surveyor, right? And they'd import them into SketchUp. And they would look something like this. So there'd be a bunch of contours. And voila, they'd have that. And they said, all right, well, I'd really like to see the surface. So grab that, and one of the tools that we added was a from scratch tool. And you just select, not from scratch, tools, sandbox. From contour, sorry.
See? Wrote these scripts.
Yeah, I wrote these.
Version 5.
From contour, sorry. And just like that, it takes and maps in your terrain. And if you want to see what it really did, it actually draped a triangulation on there, right? So we can take that terrain, and we'll leave the hidden line on. And what if you then want to modify it? So we've now got this terrain, but we're going to bulldoze some things. And so we added a tool called the Smoove tool, which is short for Smooth Mover. And it gives you a radius, and you can take radius and center it on stuff, and then you can just sort of push up and down the terrain. Or if you wanted to, you can pre-select some subset of your terrain, say something like this, and invoke that Smooth Mover, and you can move the whole thing in a more articulated way. So in this way, you can essentially sculpt up stuff. And SketchUp, by its nature, is a very effective boxy modeler. And what we were looking for here was to extend the ability for it to play with organic shapes. So once you have your terrain, there's a couple other things that you can do, but I'm just going to shortcut it and just show one called the stamp tool. So let's say that you have your extremely boxy house. Make a component out of that. And move it up in the air. And over the top. Oops. Okay, so now that house is over the top of our terrain here. And we need to set that thing in the terrain somehow. And before that was very difficult. You could move it down, if you wanted to, onto the terrain. That wasn't a problem. But you'd get this sort of situation. So your terrain was not matching. Part of your building is floating. Part of it was underneath. Doesn't look very good. There's no match there. So if I undo that move and put it back up, take the tool, grab the stamp tool, and I'm allowed to choose an offset here. Oops, right down here in the VCB. And that's how far I want to take the terrain out and how I want to sculpt it up to the house. And right here, it just stamps in a pad. And you can move that up and down. So let's say we want to be good people and we don't want water in our house. So we'll put it up a little bit higher. And now I can move that house right down onto its pad, and you're good to go. So there's similar tools for draping and that sort of thing, but it's all done in Ruby. You know, you can create some pretty complex, you know, between House Builder and Sandbox and many others. You know, Ruby is a very, if you're interested in authoring these things, you can do most anything that we can do as developers within SketchUp itself. So it's a very full-featured API.
What's a good place to get started if you want to learn Ruby scripting? Just not scare yourself to death.
Box.rb. Yeah, the question is, what's a good way to get started with Ruby scripting? And what I did was I pulled up BoxRB, and it's on your box. So it's on your machine right now. And look at the code, read the code, make changes, and run it, and just see what happens. And, you know, get your Ruby book or an online reference, and get on the forums. The Ruby forums, there's, you know, a bunch of them.
We provide a little bit of help that has kind of a general introduction. What a script is, where do you put it when you've created it. But I think Todd's dead on. The best way to learn this, even if you don't know Ruby, is to look at a very simple example of it and then think to yourself, well, how would I like to just modify it just slightly? You know, oh, okay, that worked. Now I'll try the next thing.
Okay, thank you very much, Todd. Okay, I'm going to have to go fast through some of these. Joseph has created this tool called Soap Skin Bubble. All right, and can I get an amen for how awesome this script is?
Amen.
Okay, if you wanted to like do a mast of a sailboat, you draw a triangle, you say Soap Skin Bubble, and you just tell it how much wind you want. I mean, it's really amazing. I don't have a demo of it. I have downloaded it. We want to get in the lab later, Soap Skin Bubble. is awesome. And then tensile structures as well. I may have just described tensile structures. Okay, then there's this guy called Todd Birch. Make faces. I told Daniel Tall I was going to talk about this, but I don't have time. I'm going to just go through the presentation. If you guys want a demo of these CAD cleanup scripts, find me anytime in the hallway. We'll open a computer and we'll do it. I'll show you how it works. But you can take a floor plan that's poorly drawn in AutoCAD, bring it into SketchUp, and clean it up, and you will save hours, days, cleaning this stuff up. It's amazing. Okay, Adam Billiard. Adam is like an uber programmer. He started out writing games for Atari back in the 70s. He's written this thing called LightUp, and it's a shading program that works within SketchUp. And I have a hyperlink to a YouTube video to watch it. It's great, but it's 3 minutes long, and I don't have time to show it. But you know, catch me later. I'll take you through this stuff. Yes. I heard a couple of your words in that sentence.
Does it work with Podium or exclusively with SketchUp?
LightUp works with SketchUp. Doesn't Podium is a renderer in SketchUp, and so is LightUp. They're just a little bit different. Yeah, both of them are great. He's almost finished with LightUp. It works for the most part, but I talked to him the other day, and he's going to finish it pretty soon. Okay, Chris Phillips has taken a physics engine and tied it with Ruby together to SketchUp. And I have a video hyperlink. I would love to show it. It's amazing. It's called The Orange. If anybody's seen it, it's hilarious. It's set to music. Some guy did it, and it's you can. It, awesome. Okay. Dale Martins. His idea is what? If you're on the Sketchucation forums, he's written this thing called Subdivide and Smooth. It's his first big script, and I can remember when he was getting started. Subdivide and Smooth will blow you away. I mean, it's almost nerve. If SketchUp had curves, it would be nerve modeling. You can do amazing things. You do seat cushions, anything you want to do with curvy things inside SketchUp. I'm a real rectilinear kind of guy, so the standard set of tools is good for me. But you know, if you want to do curvy things, look at Subdivide and Smooth. It's available at on Smustard. And then he's written some other things. The Indigo Exporter, I believe he wrote before Subdivide and Smooth, but that's an awesome script. Okay, Fredo didn't want to send me his picture, so I said, this is what I'm using, buddy. All right, and so do I have permission to go for a couple more minutes? Okay, I'm going to take you through this thing called Tools on Surface.
14 minutes.
I'm sorry?
14 minutes.
Oh, and then they don't have a break. Okay.
Go to 2:30.
Oh, I go to 2:30. What am I thinking? Okay, we're going to go back and watch some of that other stuff, but I'm going to do this while we're not. Okay. Duh. All right, so I'm doing Fredo's joint push-pull. Hold your question just a second. Okay, so what we have is a set of tools called Tools on Surface. All right, and I don't really, well, we'll leave the geometry showing. That's fine. Okay, and so like right now, if I wanted to draw a line from right here to right here, I did, but we can't see it because it's inside the model. That's, you know, so what? And so what you can do with Tools on Surface is draw a line on the surface. All right, that's, you know, everybody gets that. And so we draw a line. Okay, isn't that sweet? All right. Okay, so that's it. That's Tools on Surface. So the thing is it's not draw a line on surface. It's Tools on Surface. You know, he has a bunch of tools. He's going to have more. You know, rectangle on surface, circle on surface. Let's do a circle on surface real quick. All right, well, let's go over here. and let's pick a circle. Okay, yeah, that's the, yeah, he's leading into it. He says, is that a face you can push pull? Yes, okay, so let's do that. All right, I don't even think we need to select it. So we got tools on, here we want joint push pull. This is another one of his scripts. Okay, I must select at least one face, all right, and so I'll select this face. Joint push pull. All right, so, all right, so that was okay. I didn't get the whole thing. Let me get the whole thing. I'm sorry?
Turn off the geometry.
Okay, well, all right. We'll do joint. Yeah, you're right. I do want to turn off the geometry. All right. How do I turn off geometry? I write Ruby scripts. You know, I don't use this thing. All right, joint push pull. All right, so we have a face selected. It looks like you're just selecting part of the face. All right, but you're not. You're selecting the whole thing. That's, I must have used it wrong. Okay, so anyway, so that's, let's try this oddball shape over here for joint push pull. There, that one's going to work, right? So that's kind of exaggerated, but the, I mean, this, these types of tools, man, look at the hands. These types of tools take SketchUp to another level. I've heard comments from people that's like, I was getting ready to get rid of SketchUp, and I saw these tools, and I'm keeping it now. This is great. Okay, question right here.
Todd, there is a push-pull in any direction for ReScript. I'm not sure who wrote it.
Yes.
Okay,
so the comment was, is there's another script out there called
push-pull in any direction.
Does the same kind of thing.
Yeah.
Okay, very good. Question.
Do you know if the bubble will work on that surface?
Which bubble?
The one that you talked about with the sail.
The soap skin bubble? I don't know. Will soap skin bubble work on that curve face?
No, not the right use.
Not the right use. Okay, thank you. All right, another question I saw back. Yes, sir. Spell Smustard, okay.
SMU or SMA?
SMU. You know, a lot of people don't get that. You know, SketchUp is S with ketchup, and Smustard, obviously, S with mustard, so.
Brilliant.
Okay, so, all right, so I'm not going to spend any more time on that. I'm going to go back. I'm going to go back a little bit. And we're going to look at light up. Okay. Let's do this. And we have audio coming.
This is a tutorial about setting up a point light within light up. Here we have a pretty simple model of a shape in SketchUp. So first thing you want to do is to go to preferences and ensure that the use sun as a light source is turned off. I've turned it off here. Otherwise, it will just drown out all the point lights that you have. Okay, so to set up a point light, you go to the components browser and just drag a point light source into your scene, like that. Let's just position that that'll do. So what we've got there is a point light. Now, if I look at the entity information for that light source, let me just move that across, you'll see it's got a default color. So what I'm going to do is take the paint bucket and click on a color in the color chooser and just click on that and make it a green color. Okay, so now we've got our point light, we've got a green color assigned to it. We can just go ahead and press the direct lighting button. It's finished. And now the tour tool to see the results. Okay, so now you can see
inside SketchUp.
Got, this green light lighting up my shape. You can see also that it's not reaching the end. It's not strong enough to eliminate the whole model. So let's take the query tool here, click on the light source, and change the radius to make it more powerful. Okay, and update the lighting. There we go. Now, much better. The lighting's reaching all the way to the end. We've got this nice curve here from this lip. So that's pretty much it. This is a little bit dark here in this region here, so we would really want to do some ambient occlusion. So if we just go to the ambient occlusion button, generate the ambient occlusion data, just wait a few seconds while it completes. Right, there's the ambient occlusion data, and we want to blend that in with the direct lighting. So click on that again, and there's the final result. A point light lighting this shape.
That's it. Okay, so that's LightUp. You know, he's been in games programming forever, and he initially did all this in Ruby, and he was doing millions and millions of ray traces, and it just wasn't performing well, so he kind of moved some of it into C++ to speed it up, and it really did. But anyway, you know, I believe that's a free script. Okay, sketchy physics. This is movie hour.
Come fly with me, let's fly away. If you can use some exotic booze, there's a bar in far Bombay. Come fly with me, let's fly away. Come fly with me, let's float down to Peru. In Llama Land, there's a one-man band, and he'll toot his flute for you. Come fly with me, let's take off in the blue. Once I get you up there, where the air is rarefied, we'll just glide starry-eyed. Once I get you up there, I'll be holding you so near. You may hear angels cheer, 'cause we're together weather-wise. It's such a lovely day. You just say the words and we'll beat the birds down to Acapulco Bay. It's perfect for a flying honeymoon, they say. Come fly with me, let's fly, let's fly. Pack up, let's fly away.
Okay, so that's sketchy physics. Now that was, everything was in SketchUp, and a screen capture video was done. There's no way to like turn that into slides and export a movie or anything, so that was with screen capture software. But, I mean, Chris didn't write the physics package, but I still give him full credit for putting it in there. I mean, it's awesome. And then Chris also has freeform deformation, which we won't demo today, but that's awesome as well. Sketchy physics, it's free, just download it, freeform deformation, same thing. Okay, now Al Hart is going to be at a conference next week. He couldn't come. Al Hart has done a lot of work with Ruby scripts and plugins. I would encourage you to go look at his stuff at Render Plus Systems. He has like an export to a 3D PDF for SketchUp, so you can create a PDF with a rotating model inside of it. And then he's got some rendering tools as well. Sketchy Shadows, Susan Sorger, are you in here? Raise your hand. Everybody look at Susan. Okay, she'll tell you anything you want to know about the NPR tools and Sketchy Shadows. Sketchy Shadows are pretty hot. Thank you for sending me that stuff. I didn't get it in. Jim Foltz is another scripter. He's got a lot of his stuff are kind of geared more towards the Ruby people, the Ruby community to do things, but this particular custom toolbars is nice. So if you want to customize your toolbars and kind of not choose what the Ruby scripters pick for toolbars, you can use this to kind of manage your Ruby scripts. And so that's really nice. Okay, a lot of exporters. Some of these are Ruby-based, some of these aren't, but as far as, there's Podium, LightUp, Skin2Go, SketchUp, Turkithia, Render Plus, and POV, all of these, and there's probably going to be more of them. I mean, it's amazing what the people are doing with these things today. I really want to show you guys my CAD cleanup scripts, okay? And so we'll have to do that in the lab. One last thing we're going to do is we're going to download a script real quick. We'll go to smuster.com. If you guys don't have Windowizer, we'll show you how to do Windowizer. So you scroll down here to Windowizer version 3, you click on it, you say download, and it is now in my downloaded files. Okay? And I don't know where that is on this computer. But what you would do is you would go into Finder. How do I get the dock? All right, so you go into Finder. Now, on Windows, it's different. But on a Mac, you go Macintosh hard drive, library, application support, Google SketchUp 6, SketchUp, plugins, and you stick it in there. Okay, your plugins, if you don't have any Ruby scripts, won't have a whole lot of stuff in it. It'll look like this. These four things will be in it, examples through utilities. And then you just put the Windowizer script in there, drag and drop it, and you're done. You exit SketchUp, go back in, and you got Windowizer. Yes, sir?
So I noticed there's a couple of places you can put Ruby scripts, one being under tools, I think.
Yes.
One being under Ruby.
Yes. Okay, the question is, he notices there's two valid places to put RubyScript, the plugins folder and the tools folder. It's best for us to put them in the plugins folder. They'll work just as well in the tools folder, but what we're trying to do from a community with Google kind of thing is coordinate our efforts, and so the Google stuff goes in the tools folder and the user community stuff goes in the plugins folder. Now, not all scripts adhere to that, but the plugins folder is the best place for them, for us. It makes it easier to migrate to the next version. Yes?
Is it just as simple to remove your plugin?
Yes. You drag it to your trash or you delete it. You stop SketchUp, start it back up, it's gone. Yes, that's how you delete it. Yes, question?
Don't you have to have something turned on in SketchUp for this to work?
The question is, do you have to have something turned on in SketchUp for this to work? And yes, you do. Some of the scripts that register themselves. And so we'll go into SketchUp, and I'll show you that real quick. It's in Preferences, and under SketchUp, it's right here. And then you will look under Extensions, all right? And so like Soap, Skin, Bubble, and Subdivide and Smooth are registered as extensions. Most scripts aren't. Some are. More will probably be doing it. And you just make sure that those are clicked. I just click everything, and everything's fine. Cohen. Can I show offset on surface? No, I don't have time. Yes, question.
Can you tell us the general difference between an extension and Ruby?
The question is, what's the difference between an extension and a Ruby? Nothing. There's really no difference, other than the Ruby script makes a couple calls to the SketchUp API saying, register me as an extension. So in that essence, you can turn it off and turn it on without deleting the script. So that would be the difference. Yes, question.
Todd. Let me comment on that. The only reason the extension stuff is there is that we wanted the ability to ship stuff to you guys that is not on by default in the interface. So if you want your Ruby script to have that behavior, maybe it's applicable. For instance, the sandbox tools is why we did this. it's only applicable if you're interested in doing kind of organic modeling with SketchUp. So we put that extension mechanism in it. And you're welcome to use it, of course, but you don't have to.
Yes?
Yeah, SketchUp actually...
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, the question was, will we package a set of kind of example scripts for people who maybe want to get started writing scripts and learn a little bit about? And we already do, actually. If you go into the extensions there and turn on the examples, and those are in your plugins directory already, and that's where box.rb is and a few other things like that. Ruby scripts are just a text file. It's just an ASCII text file. You're welcome to do it in Notepad or TextEdit on the Mac, but there are a few IDEs that are built that'll do syntax highlighting and that sort of thing for you. It's actually in the help menu.
Yeah, the API documentation, if you go into help and you say Ruby help, it's on the web, and if you'll get it. And
the other place it is code.google.com.
The aspect ratio is not set up right, but in Ruby there's classes and methods, and you just click on one of those, and that's all the different calls for all the different classes. So all the doc is right there. Any other questions? Question?
No, not at all. It's just a preference of
Repeat
whether.
Repeat the question.
It's basically, the question is whether you have the extensions turned on or off, does it degrade the performance in SketchUp to have a bunch of scripts in? And the answer is no. They're only taking up cycles when you're actually exercising those scripts.
Right. Yes, sir.
Todd, you can answer.
Yeah. The question is, when you're writing a script and you need to reload it, and maybe you know you're in the development process, you want to reload it. There's a under the window menu, there's this thing called the Ruby console. All right, and so it's a dialog box where you can enter Ruby commands or Ruby expressions, and you would use the load command, all right? There's one of the, it's a Ruby command, load, and you would give it the directory path, there's a command stack, and so you just hit the up arrow key or down arrow key to go through your command stack. So what I typically do when I'm developing scripts, I'll load it up manually and run it, go back and change it, reload it. So once it's loaded, you don't unload it, you just reload it. So yeah, it's a pretty interactive, and you use the Ruby console quite a bit when you're in development. Typical user wouldn't use the Ruby console. Okay, we're out of time. Thank you guys so much for coming. See me in the lab.